This is Duke University.
Dr. Botstein, you similarly said that the barbarism we witness today is, quote, old-fashioned and not particularly novel. And so you also say, though, later, that humans can progress through language and through learning. And I was wondering if you could speak a bit about what's the role of language in ethics for the human race?
Language is one, not the only medium, that is, we presumably are hardwired to possess. It's a complicated instrument because it appears as if we communicate, but actually we don't. The really strange thing about language is we talk all the time, but I'm never certain that actually one of the real, one great writer won the Nobel Prize, Elias Canetti, once said that the greatest fraud perpetrated on thinking people is the idea that language communicates. You tell the child, write. Well, in some simplistic way, sure, you know, directions, if they're written coherently, can communicate how to use a machine or to drive around the town. But let me get something more complicated, the kind of question you're asking. People hear what they want to hear. The meanings of words are always unstable. Even the semantics is unstable. People will read a book written 75 years ago and they think it's the same language. I'm always amazed when people say, we have to read it in the original language. These are pretentious people, you know. As if the language that they're reading just because they're English speakers, that reading Dickens is their language. It's not their language. The language that they know is English has as little to do with Dickens as it does with the French of Paul Valéry. So the translation of Valéry into English is no more or less authentic than their reading the English language just because they played the game of telephone, which is many generations have thought they're saying something. You know the game of telephone. You're in a circle, children play, and they whisper into one person's ear, and by the end, hello is goodbye. Now imagine playing telephone over many generations. The chance of any accuracy in oral transmission is zero. So this notion of language being a shared, but there is something to it. It's not totally one or the other. So our task, it seems to me, is to think very carefully of how we speak and what we say and whether we actually do communicate. And one of the things that we have to fight is the use of language by the shared media we all consume. There's one real triumph of the Bush administration, for example. It's in sloganeering. No child left behind. Well, every child has been left behind. But there is a phrase which has nothing to do with reality, actually. It doesn't describe reality. The way we create phraseology and circumlocutions, often, or surrogates for things we say, all politicians try to do it. The Obama administration, all politicians, all major media outlets do it. And our attention span being reduced, the amount of language we can contain is very distilled. So these are problems we have, but the task we have is to try to use the shared linguistic capacity to bridge and to be aware of when we're not communicating when we think we are, which is a very dangerous thing. And universities, in my view, the last thing I'll say about this is that we are committed to the idea that language is the instrument of exchange, not violence. The only condition for the flowering of human imagination and human ethics is when violence is placed at the door. So language is the dominant and exclusive instrument of negotiation, exchange, and contact in the university environment. That's why you cannot carry, there may be a right to carry guns, but I doubt there's a right to carry guns on the Duke campus. Not because it's not your constitutional right to do so in your home, someplace elsewhere, but finally, there's no even conversation if I am carrying a loaded revolver. And I say, let's just talk. That eviscerates the power of language. And in democracy, language is the instrument of politics, not violence.
So did I misquote you horribly?
I certainly said that that I'm not at all sure I'm a believer in the notion of progress, certainly. Yeah, I think the second remark was probably a joke.
Do you think that that language, though, has a place in your version of virtue ethics in similar to what Botstein is talking about. I don't believe from your writings that you believe that we're progressing ethically, but I think there is power in language.
Sure. I mean, and I think perhaps the best way to describe it is to talk about the way the notion of what faith is has changed significantly in what you might call the post-Immanuel Kant, post-Charles Darwin era, the era of the last 250 years or so. There was a time before that era when people would think of religious faith as being largely about propositional truth, that there was no question that the Bible, which was often harmonized very much with the works of the classical era, Aristotle and Plato and Cicero and so on, represented a this equals that notion of the world. It was an accurate factual description of the way the world was. Well, clearly with the philosophical and scientific revolutions, you know, that became a very problematic way of understanding things for a lot of people. And along with the Enlightenment turn to the subject, that created the idea, which is still, you know, alive and well, particularly in the American church and American religious life in general, that fundamentally what faith was about was a disposition in your own heart, and faith kind of describes your own inner dispositions and your expressions of them. And that can often be a way in which different religious traditions can talk to each other, because a Buddhist can say, I have this experience when I pray, and a Methodist can have, I actually have a remarkable similar experience when I pray, and there can be an interesting conversation that happens there. I guess I'm one of those that's been more influenced in recent generations, in the last sort of 50 years or so, by those who've said that actually religious faith is more like a culture and more like a language. It's about learning the kind of rules of discourse that Dr. Botstein was referring to, learning that, for example, to continue where he finished, the moment you get out the gun is a sign that you've lost the argument. And so keeping peace is a linguistic activity that preserves a form of discourse and interaction with one another that prevents people from resorting to violence. And religious faith to learn a religious faith is like learning a language. It's like learning a whole set of rules, grammatical rules, but it's also about learning etiquette and, you know, different kinds of rules. And that's very much the way I try to, when I do preach, which is frequently, I'm not telling people this is the way you must live. I'm trying to introduce people to a language and to invite people into a culture, into a way of life. And so I think a language is a very appropriate way of describing both education and religious faith today.
Produced by Duke University.